They say life's like a book. You are the author of the blank pages. Some choose to write without editing, let the story play out. But others? Others change and backspace and edit until their book is perfect. The Pursuit of Happiness by Chris Gardner. Part 1. February 9th, 1954. Christopher Paul Gardner is born in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. Chris didn't know his father. He grew up with his mother and older sister. Eventually, when he was around 2, his mother went to jail. He never knew why exactly, but he and Ophelia went to live with his Uncle Archie and his wife, Titi. They treated them well, though lived by strict rules in the home and valued responsibility. Chapter 2. The No Daddy Blues. Once his mother returned from prison with her new daughter, Chris was stuck with Freddie, his mother's boyfriend. He was abusive to Chris and his family, verbally and physically, and a suffering alcoholic. After kicking him out numerous times, week by week he would return, and Chris's mother would allow him each and every time. One night, as Freddie was drunk again, his mother told him and his sisters to pack up their things, and they escaped to a small apartment to hide from Freddie. He found them easily and forced them back into his life. Chris fantasized about killing Freddy with bleach, a knife, and even a gun. However, his mother randomly disappeared again, and he was sent to live with his relatives, jumping around from his 3 uncles. His Uncle Willie was a great role model for Chris, telling him, "The world is your oyster. It's up to you to find the pearls." Between the ages of 10 and 14, Chris worked in on-the-job training as a gopher, or a personal assistant or intern. He also helped his sister raise her daughter from the foster home. When he was 13, Chris decided to shoplift a pair of pants. He was caught by 2 white cops who beat him and took him to the police station. Freddie refused to pick him up for a few hours, but eventually humiliated Chris when he did later that day. In his teenage years, Chris educated himself by reading literature daily, in an attempt to help his future. When he was 16, he joined the football team, but was cut because the coach found radical black literature in his locker. This ended all of Chris's interest in athletics. The rest of high school, Chris spent working, dating women way out of his league, and deciding what he wanted to do with his life. After he graduated, Chris enlisted in the Navy, in the hopes of leaving behind a past life and finding consolation in the world he had yet to explore. Chris began boot camp for the Navy in Orlando, Florida, where the structure was a sweet change from his roller coaster lifestyle of growing up with Freddie. After training, Chris was stationed to a college-like camp in North Carolina, where he worked, learned, and thrived in a hospital where Marines and special patients were contained. Chris worked for months at the station, gathering skill and credibility among his peers and supervisors. And when one of his superiors broke off to start his own medical lab, he invited Chris to join him. Chris decided to risk it all and transfer to the San Francisco lab for a higher salary and more benefits. One night, Chris called his old girlfriend from high school, Sherry Dyson, and realized he still loved her. Chris jokingly asked Sherry, "Hey, when are we getting married?" And she responded, "How about June 18th? And they did. They got married June 18th, as promised. Chris moved around from job to job, painting and moving as called, but couldn't find a steady source of income for his tiny family. Sherry and Chris were having trouble with their relationship, as Chris worked to provide, but was more focused on other women and less interested in Sherry. At 26, Chris met Jackie, a woman living only a few blocks from Sherry and him, who he immediately fell in love with. Keeping their relationship on the down low, Chris snuck around for months, skipping work and going out late to be with Jackie. Eventually, Chris told Sherry he was leaving her. It took 9 years to settle all of the divorce papers, mostly due to the drama. After all, Jackie had become pregnant after knowing Chris for less than a month. Chris Gardner Jr. arrived on January 28, 1981. Changing Chris's entire focus for the rest of his life. Fatherhood became the priority, as Chris promised himself at a very young age that he would be the father he never had. Jackie and Chris struggled to raise an infant in a one-room apartment, as Chris couldn't make enough money to support them, and Jackie was constantly reminding him of it. When she began to work, Jackie and Chris were forced to solve problems with Chris Jr. together, but their relationship was crumbling, and Jackie threatened to leave. Chris found a sales job for a medical company and began working to sell equipment. One day, when walking downtown, Chris noticed a man driving a Ferrari in the parking lot. He was amazed and asked the man, "What do you do and how do you do that?" The man responded that he was a stockbroker who made $80,000 a month. Chris and the man, named Bob Russell, went to lunch and discussed his job as a stockbroker. Chris believed he could do that. He interviewed many places but was unsuccessful. Chris eventually made connections with E.F. Hutton, a friendly broker who was able to get Chris an interview at a brokerage firm called Dean Witter. So Chris went back to working helter-skelter jobs, painting houses, and doing hard labor for various businesses. One day, while getting Christopher ready for daycare, Chris was taken to jail by two police officers for unpaid parking tickets. He was sentenced to 10 days since he couldn't pay the money, and had to call Dean Witter to reschedule their meeting. When Chris returned home, Jackie and Christopher were nowhere to be found. Chris was devastated. Where was his son? Chris goes to his interview the next morning, dressed in paint-splattered clothing because his stuff was gone. In the interview, he tells the truth about why he's dressed unprofessionally, leaving out the fact that he'd gone to jail, and offers Chris the training program starting the next day. For the next few weeks, Chris balanced a troubled home life and a successful work life. Christopher and Jackie had still not returned, and Chris was stuck crashing at friends and family members' homes, and even at work, sleeping under his desk for a few nights. And 4 months after leaving, Jackie returns with 2-year-old Christopher, leaving him in the care of Chris. She departs instantly, and Chris realizes they are officially homeless. They travel the streets as Chris looks for a daycare for Christopher that is cheap and reliable. The one he chooses has a sign on the wall calling the daycare a place of happiness. Chris wondered what kind of daycare couldn't spell happiness correctly, and made sure Christopher knew the correct spelling. "Okay, Papa, happiness," he says. All Chris wants is for them to find that. When Chris could no longer afford daycare, Christopher began to go to work with him and occupy himself at Chris's desk. Chris eventually sold most of their possessions, leaving them with only a few items: a duffel bag, briefcase, hanging bag, Pampers box, and umbrella. They moved to a small motel costing only $10 a night, and stayed there whenever they could. On weekends, Chris and his son chose to take advantage of it, but as winter comes, Chris is forced to start standing in food lines. This was one of the darkest times in his life. Chris became good friends with the pastor of the main church they got food from, and the pastor told Chris he could stay with Christopher every few nights at a small hotel in the church. One night, Chris and his son were forced to stay in a single bathroom at the train station, holding the door closed when people knocked and being silent so they could sleep there. Finally, a few weeks later, Chris comes across an abandoned building swept by the owner. Chris asks if he'd be willing to rent them the home, and he says yes. Chris and Christopher have somewhere to live. When they moved into their new home, family and friends offered them mattresses, furniture, dishes, and other home commodities. They could afford one plate of dinner, and Chris made sure that the diner played Chris's favorite song, "Rocket Love" by Stevie Wonder. For once in his life, watching his son chow down on his food while all the while dancing to his favorite song, Chris was actually happy. Jenny. He got in touch with an executive at a neighboring brokerage firm, Bear Stearns. The man offered Chris a job there, saying he was wasting his time at Dean Witter, and said that Chris could have $5,000 a month. Chris happily quit Dean Witter and began at Bear Stearns. Over the next year, Chris and Christopher lived in the heart of San Francisco again. When Chris made his first million, he decided to move to New York, leaving Christopher with now pregnant Jackie, who had conceived a baby girl a few months ago with Chris when she came to visit. He vowed to never be gone for good, but for his children to spend some time with their mothers. Chris and his children moved to Chicago, where he opened his brand new brokerage firm, Gardner, Rich & Company. As Chris raises his children, he broke the cycle of fatherless children that his father had started. His success grew as his life did, and he couldn't help but to remember where he'd come from. As Chris says, "I try to remember how far I've come, and appreciate every baby step of the way. To stand in amazement and joy that the pursuit never ends."